Retro. No.
Hello there. This is James Arnold Taylor, the voice of Obi-Wan Kenobi, and whenever I'm in this part of the galaxy, I listen to Dennis and Jay on podcast Stardust. Makes flying a little more tolerable. Don't tell Anakin.
This is podcast Stardust.
This station is now the ultimate power in the universe.
With Dennis Keithley and Jay Krebs.
Your behavior is continually unexpected.
The galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion.
Now witness the firepower of this fully armed and operational battle station.
Hello, I'm Dennis Keithley.
And I'm Jay Krebs.
And welcome to another fully armed and operational edition of Podcast Stardust. This is the galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion. Jay, can you remind everyone where they might find us around the internet?
We are on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. And we can be reached by email at podcaststardust@retrozap.com.
Today, we are coming to the climax of Volume 1 of Genndy Tartakovsky's Clone Wars, which covers chapters 17 through 20. And most of this discussion is going to be about Anakin's duel with Asajj Ventress. And this is some really, really cool action. I cannot wait to get into this.
Same. Definitely. Let's do it.
All right. So chapter 17 starts off with Anakin and Asajj arriving at Yavin 4. And they land, and Anakin begins his search for quote-unquote him. He doesn't really know yet who he is up against. He leaves R4 behind to watch the ship, and just as he begins his search through the jungle, the clones arrive, and Anakin's like immediately discerns that Obi-Wan send you? Yes, sir. You know, give your orders to follow me? Yes, sir. Fine, spread out.
There's not much else you can do at that point.
Right. Not it mirrors surprised. That same kind of delivery that we had a few chapters ago where it was Obi-Wan on Moonalist saying, that's not one of ours. Yes, sir. That was Anakin.
Right.
Who was that? What was that? Don't know, sir. That was Anakin. Yes, sir. And so I kind of appreciate this symmetry that was here. And so he sends the clones out to spread out and start looking for this mystery assailant. Well, then Asajj takes down the clones one by one through various force techniques, beating them against trees, dragging them into the underbrush where she disposes of them. It kind of has a predator type of feel.
Yes, definitely. And I have to say, though, I remember when my kids were little and we were watching this, they thought this was really funny. You know, because it's just happening. They thought it was like, oh my gosh, what's happening? Until, of course, they realize who it was. And then subsequent watching, then they realize what was actually happening. And there was a lot more to the story than what they thought. But there is, you know, just, I guess, a little bit of a comedic kind of a tone to it, if you want to see it that way. But it is very predator-like if you look at it from that point of view as well. So as Obi-Wan said, it's all from a certain point of view.
Certainly, yeah. The other thing that occurred to me is that there's a shot where you see from a distance the clones wading through some foliage that looks to be about knee-high, waist-high or so. And it reminds me of some shots that we got from Jurassic Park, The Lost World, where a bunch of these mercenaries go fleeing through a field and you can see their tracks as the velociraptors close in on them.
Oh, yeah.
And it was a very similar feel to like that. You know, you can see the predator perspective here. And I just really like that one as well. But Asajj disposes of all the clones and then she blows up both the clones transport and then Anakin's ship. And then R4's little dome comes bouncing over to Anakin's feet. And Asajj emerges from the flames of the explosion, so Anakin finally knows what he is up against. And then Anakin goes a little bit dark side here and says, I'm going to make you pay for what you've done. And Asajj responds with, your fall will be my ascension to the Sith. The sabers ignite, and as the episode ends, they exchange their initial blows. So, I don't know, I liked all these chapters, but this was very, very well paced.
Oh, definitely. And you know, all of these chapters that we're getting here coming up, there's not a whole lot of dialogue, which realistically you don't need it. Right. And even Anakin saying, I sense something, you know, it was, that's almost like, really, Anakin, duh. Mm-hmm. He didn't even need to say that. But, you know, I understand that you have probably have to have at least a little bit of a voice actor kind of a thing to narrate some of what is going on. But honestly, he could have just looked around and yeah, it would have conveyed the exact same message.
Right. These chapters are very efficient.
Oh, yeah.
In telling the story. We've said this before, but there's just a few minutes of each, but they pack a lot of story there and they don't use words gratuitously there. Mm-hmm. Why tell us something when they can show us something? Mm-hmm. And that's what they did in this here. One of the things that stood out to me here is that, of course, the Clone Wars at this point that Dave Filoni did are far more famous, but Asajj was always a rival for Obi-Wan. And although Asajj faced off against Anakin a time or two, it's typically Obi-Wan that is the one that is confronting Asajj Ventress and has the banter with Asajj Ventress. And looking at this in reverse, because Clone Wars came first, Genndy Tartakovsky's work came first, it just was kind of blaring to me that it was Anakin confronting her and not Obi-Wan Kenobi.
That is an interesting point, and it makes you wonder what the, you know, the change was in terms of how they wanted to interpret it. Yeah, I like that. That's very, very profound. Another thing too, for me anyways, is that in this series, which again, it's the efficiency of it with such short chapters, we don't get anything more from the clones than just these very short, you know, little clippy kinds of interactions. And they really do give you the feeling that they are just sort of robotic in a lot of ways, and that they don't have a whole lot of personality, and that they're all about the mission, and that they're all about, you know, doing what they need to do. And we get a lot more personable with them in the Clone Wars.
Oh,
so
definitely.
I I've always loved the clones, and that's just something that I've always been completely fascinated with. So when we did start to explore that in Dave Filoni's Clone Wars, I was so grateful for that. So as much as I love these, there's that element there that I appreciate so much more.
There's definitely something to that. I think Clone Wars by Genndy Tartakovsky is much more in alignment with what George Lucas was exploring in the movies and then later changed his mind when he was working with Dave Filoni in the Clone Wars, in that the clones were simply another version of the battle droids. Sure. The battle droids were mindless, killing, fighting machines. And the Clone Wars were an innovation on that same model. That was the Republic's answer to battle droids. They were a superior version of that, bred in mass from a single template, just like the battle droids were. Battle droids were created from a single design. There wasn't any variation from one B1 battle droid to another.
Right.
Or B2 to another, you know, the average one. They were all the same thing. Same thing with the clones. And it was not until we got to the Clone Wars where we got to see that they had different personalities, where that got to be fleshed out. But I think what we saw in Clone Wars is much more in keeping with the portrayal of the clones in the movies that we've seen. So, good point.
Right, right. And the only other thing that stands out to me here too is when Asajj is coming across the wreckage and she just steps right on the Republic symbol. You know, it's very, very prophetic, I guess you could say. Very symbolic.
Disrespectful, yeah.
Yes. And poor Azure Angel, there goes his ship.
Yeah, well, you
and
know.
R4.
And again, it's a Tinker with another one, so.
But the look on his face was like, at first it was like, did that just happen? And then of course it switches to,
Yeah, well, he's got an ego there, so.
Oh, yeah.
Well, chapter 18 picks up right where chapter 17 left off. The duel continues, and they're going all out against each other. The late lightsaber assault is ferocious. They're using the force to manipulate the environment, especially on Asajj's part. There's a lot of force pushes, and then Asajj pulls a move that we've seen previously from Darth Vader in The Empire Strikes Back by basically throwing everything in the environment at Anakin and making him defend himself from all directions, whether it's logs or vines or whatever is around him. She's using the environment to her advantage. And then Anakin disarms Asajj momentarily. She disappears into the trees and summons her lightsaber back to her. Anakin lands on a branch, and Asajj, who is hiding around the side of a tree, uses the force to collapse underneath. That makes me laugh. I'm not sure it was supposed to be a comedic moment, but there it is. Anakin grabs a vine with a force. Asajj slices a vine with her saber and sends him tumbling. He, of course, grabs onto another branch. They're making a lot of great use of their environment throughout. And they spring off trees. They're going pass by pass, fighting with each other. And it's kind of like Anakin and Obi-Wan at the end of Revenge of the Sith, when they're both grabbing onto cables and taking those passing swipes at each other as they're swinging around that part of the base on Mustafar that's fallen off into the lava.
Yes, definitely. And there's so many great little moments in here, and it goes by so fast. But the use of the shadows, the use of the sound effects, the saber clashing, all of the rustling of the trees and the leaves, and just the way that everything is framed is just, it's so good. It's just so good. This part of the series is probably some of the most well done in the entire chapters that we've had, all of them.
Right. So ultimately the battle here ends up at the Masasi Temple in this chapter. And when they get there, Asajj continues to make great use of her environment. She's flinging stones from the temple through the force at Anakin, and he's forced to defend himself. At this point, he's taken enough abuse that his robes are pretty tattered looking. And as this chapter comes to an end, the clouds have rolled in. It starts to rain. We get this great effect of the raindrops impacting their lightsabers and evaporating into steam there, or water vapor at the very least. And they're kind of left there. Asajj is standing on top of the temple. She's got her lightsabers held out to each side, pointing forward. She's very stoic looking, just kind of waiting for what comes next. And Anakin's below her, looking up at her, waiting to bring it on next. Mm-hmm. It is a really cool conclusion to this chapter.
Definitely. And, you know, this also makes me think back to some of the things that we were talking about before with the story being of legend, you know, with the little boy that was watching Mace Windu, because there's so many abilities that they're doing throughout this whole thing where they're literally flying through the air and they're fighting with their lightsabers. They're jumping these huge, huge leaps into the treetops. And, you know, it's very superhuman in a lot of ways. But I remember reading some of the Legends books at the time that these had come out. And I just remember mention of force powers that we don't really hear much of anymore. And one of them that, pardon the pun, but sticks in my mind is force stick. So when you would jump on something, you would force stick yourself to a branch or, you know, a ledge or whatever. Mm-hmm. And so that just came to mind once again when I was rewatching these.
Yeah, for me, it was very much a video game maneuver where you would jump up to one wall and there would be that moment of stickiness where you bounced off of it onto the next wall. And then it was kind of a parkour type of a thing.
There you go.
We go back and forth up the walls. You've seen it in Batman games and some various Star Wars games and the like there. And it made very good use of the stunt work and acrobatics and special effects and that we saw in movies of the time. And your description of kind of the mythological legendary stories really works here. Mm-hmm. And we'll get into that a little bit later in this discussion too, especially when we get to the final chapter. But yeah, it is very much the way you might describe an epic battle between two combatants. It rages across the planet and ends up at this Masasi temple where they have their climactic part of the confrontation.
And the standoff is just great in the rain. And they're just, and that's where this chapter ends, is that they're just staring at each other like this standoff.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And Asajj very much gets this wild banshee look to her.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's really great. So chapter 19 starts off with, let me just describe this. Chapter 19, I've subtitled this, "The Tide Has Turned. Anakin Isn't Messing Around Anymore." But so we pick up with them standing there facing each other in the rain. And Anakin makes a force leap to take the attack to Asajj. And he's really on the offensive now. He force pushes Asajj off the ledge she's on and into the temple. Mm-hmm. And once she gets in there, she kind of hides a little bit. Again, this is a tactic of hers. She disappears and then makes Anakin look for her. And when she can, she takes advantage of the environment around her. But there's a great shot. It's not fair to say this for as primitive or as inferior as you might call the art to what we see in the Clone Wars, because the Clone Wars takes advantage of 3D rendering and computers and everything else that Clone Wars did not have. But it's still beautiful in Clone Wars. So I hate to disparage it with those titles, but I just can't think of another way to describe it. But for the 2D animation that they use, there are some great images of these puddles that Anakin is wandering through with his lightsaber lit, and the blade is just kind of wavy as it's in the water, the way it might look in a puddle. It was a very nice touch of Genndy Tartakovsky and his crew.
I totally agree with you. And I picked up on that as well. And just the way that the camera kind of pans up from those puddles and then just, you know, shows Anakin as this hero, essentially.
Right. And they do a lot with color in this chapter. In the early part of this chapter, we get a lot of the reflection on Anakin with his blue lightsaber. So he's frequently highlighted in blue. Meanwhile, Asajj has got her true red lightsaber, so she's highlighted with this red glow from her sabers, which is going to change, so pay attention. And the so Anakin's looking for Asajj, and he finally finds her, and he starts driving her back. He's no longer reacting to her. He's taking the attack to her. The music starts to get frantic, and she's on the defensive. Asajj throws a pillar from the interior of this temple right at Anakin. He doesn't flinch. He just reaches out with the force and deflects it right back at her. She gets the shocked look on her face right as she gets beaten down with the thing. I mean, it is just, she's just having to resist the onslaught now. She came into this battle with the utmost confidence that this Anakin that she's heard about, this little Padawan, this nobody that she's been sent out to kill, isn't going to be a challenge, and she's going to become a Sith. And she's starting to face the reality that this was not as easy as she thought it was.
Right. And one of my favorite shots from that whole sequence is when Anakin is running up the stairs and Asajj tries to force push him. And then you just see Anakin kind of shimmer almost as though he's just shrugging off this force push, and he doesn't stop. And and she is a little bit concerned at that point.
It reminds me, if you're watching football and the running back or a receiver has got the ball and they lower their shoulder and kind of shrug off the tackle from the defender, that is exactly what I thought of when I saw that. That stood out to me as well. So Anakin, like you said, runs through that force push, and then he basically throws her right through a wall, and her clothes are now tattered as well. They are fighting on the outside of the temple, and he is forcing her back up the stairs to the top. So she's retreating under the barrage of his assault. And as they get to the top, the planet of Yavin itself is red. So they're backlit in red, and she's got her red sabers. Anakin has got his blue. And this is very mood setting and is foreshadowing of what is about to happen here.
Definitely. And, you know, it is kind of crazy that Anakin is following her up the stairs as she's going backwards. She still technically has the high ground as he's chasing her up the stairs. You know what I mean? But that backlit, and as you said, the foreshadowing, because there's that one point where she's trying to bring her lightsaber down on him and he grabs her by the wrist. And as the lightsaber is coming down, that's when you really see his face light up in red.
Exactly. You beat me right to that. Because they get to the top of the temple, they're getting out onto a part of the temple that has crumbled through the ages, and it's overlooking a ravine. She makes a maneuver that causes him to lose his lightsaber. It goes tumbling down floors behind him, and she goes in for the kill with both hands. He grabs her wrists, and he forces her to drop one of her sabers, which he then picks up with a force. It is eerie because Duel of the Fates starts playing.
Yes. Oh, yeah.
And the saber rises slowly. He grabs it in his hand and ignites it. And then his face is all illuminated in red. Mm-hmm. And then you get this series of flashes. And each one reveals kind of like a Jedi looking on him through the force. You get Qui-Gon, you get Yoda, you get Obi-Wan. And they've all got these look of alarms. And he's yelling. you know, yeah, as he's just battering her with his lightsaber. And eventually, it's not his lightsaber that does the job. It's the strength of his salt shatters what's left of the temple underneath her, and she goes plummeting into the ravine. And then he just tosses in that Sith saber after her.
Chilling. It really is. It really is. Especially because you know that Anakin has been faced with this before with the raid on the Tusken Raider camp. Mm-hmm. When he heard Qui-Gon's voice saying, "Anakin, no!" And he ignored it then as well. So, yeah, so this is just kind of a full circle back to that. And you're right, it is. It's very chilling.
Right, and then there's that shot of him standing with his legs spread wide. You're looking up at him from kind of below the cliff, and his clothes are in tatters. He's got Asajj's saber in his hand. It's glowing red. He yells one more time right before he throws that saber in there. And it's just kind of like, wow. I mean, talk about some excellent foreshadowing for what will happen in the Revenge of the Sith there. It was just absolutely amazing. You can see the anger in him and why some of the Jedi were right to fear him.
Definitely.
When it came down to it. Very, very, very well done.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that brings us to our concluding chapter of Volume 1. That's Chapter 20. Starts off on Moonalist, where we see a wolfman, as they're known in Star Wars as the Shistavenin. Is that sound right?
Sounds pretty good to me. Shistavenin.
Yeah, we saw the first one of these in the cantina in A New Hope. Mm-hmm. But this guy's name is Master Vulif Mon, and he is battling battle droids. A bunch of clone troopers arrive in gunships, and right as they gain the upper hand, the Bangin clan surrenders, and all these droids go limp. That's funny, because one of them kind of like goes into that deactivated shrug as a blaster bolt hits it and knocks it over. We then next see the Bangin clan being led away in binders, and Obi-Wan is kind of monitoring everything that's going on. And our trooper informs that Asajj's ship is returning. Of course, they don't know it's Asajj, but that a ship is returning. And he informs that Obi-Wan, all batteries are standing by. Obi-Wan clearly senses that it's Anakin through the Force because he tells everyone to hold their fire. And the ship makes some flashy maneuvers. Pure Anakin. And as it lands, the cockpit opens. Anakin hops out. He apologizes to Anakin. He says it was a trap by the Sith. He ran straight into it, but he was victorious. And then Obi-Wan admonishes him, indeed, but the battle should never have been fought. I find the Sith's interest in you most troublesome.
Yeah. Okay,
the word foreshadowing has come up an awful lot in this episode, but no more appropriate than here.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I have to go back to the way that Anakin landed that ship too, with, like you said, with his kind of, you know, flamboyance and that type of thing. So, I mean, he still hasn't lost himself. You know, of course we know this. He hasn't lost himself completely, but he's almost like he wants Obi-Wan to be proud of him. You know, right. He's doing it not just because he wants to be flamboyant, but because he wants Obi-Wan to be proud. And you can see it on his face when he lands too. And Obi-Wan just standing there with his arms crossed as usual.
Yeah. Oftentimes with Anakin, I get the feeling he's trying to prove his worth. Mm-hmm. And it's kind of a concept that where someone gets hired by a company to do a particular job. And so they will do things that aren't always the nicest and friendliest things that they could have done to the people around them or to their vendor or whatever, but they have to prove their worth to their employer. So they'll gratuitously say things that don't necessarily need to be said, but it's just a way of proving that they're on top of it. Or, I have these skills. Aren't you glad you have me around? Mm-hmm. And that's totally the feeling I got with Anakin here when he's making that landing.
Right.
That it's just that, you know, I may have disobeyed your orders, but look how good I am.
Yeah, exactly. Just like a little puppy dog. Back to the other thing that you were saying too, I find the Sith's interest in you most troublesome, because as you said with foreshadowing, the ultimate Sith's and his interest in Anakin was very troublesome indeed.
Yeah, and we get the idea from everything that comes in canon that Sidious had set up this long game, that ultimately the apprentice he was interested in was Anakin, but he roped Darth Tyrannus, you know, Count Dooku, into this as well. You know, Tyrannus was the one that recruited Asajj Ventress to go after and quote unquote assassinate Anakin Skywalker here. And so I kind of wonder in this version of the continuity what Dooku knew, if he would have been truly disappointed that Asajj failed in this regard.
Oh, that's a good point. That's a good point.
Or what the end game, as far as Dooku knew, was for all this. Because in the Clone Wars that Dave Filoni put it out, Asajj was a trusted assassin. And when Sidious told Dooku it was time to get rid of her, he was reluctant
right
at first.
Exactly.
But he never got that opportunity here in Clone Wars.
Yeah, you almost feel, you know, get the feeling that she's a little bit more disposable. You know, I hate to use that word, but But again, you know, I know I keep like harping on this interest, but it goes back to, in my mind, in The Phantom Menace, when Palpatine says to Anakin, "We shall watch your career with great interest."
Oh, yeah.
You know?
Absolutely. Yeah. And that's just it. It's Sidious recognized from very early on that this is ultimately the one that he wanted, but the Jedi were aware of Anakin. Mm-hmm. So he couldn't just snatch Anakin out from underneath him.
Sure.
And train him as a Sith. He had to let them develop him for him. Yeah, they did the heavy lifting.
Exactly.
and then he did the conversion late in life. So there we go. So Obi-Wan and Anakin's reunion is interrupted by an emergency transmission from Master Barak, who is currently on Hypori. And this is the location of a techno-union droid foundry that the Republic is attacking. Master Barak and his fellow Jedi need an immediate evac, because they've been overrun by General Grievous and his battle droids. The action then cuts to Hypori, and we see Barak's holotransmitter roll out of his dead hand and immediately gets crushed by what we would come to learn is General Grievous's foot. We then see legions of battle droids, B2 battle droids, super battle droids, whatever you want to call them, as they are converging on an acclimator Jedi cruiser that has crashed on the middle of this planet. And this goes back to the imagery we've seen a lot in Clone Wars, where there's too many droids to actually see. They've drawn so many of these things. They're far more than any episode that we ever see in the Clone Wars. And as they are converging on the battleship, we begin to see various Jedi retreating further and further back into the wreckage of the acclimator cruiser. We also finally get a back shot of General Grievous. He raises a hand to stop the battle droids from attacking. We then see Ki Adamundi, and he's muttering, "Why have they stopped?" And so the Jedi complete their retreat into the cruiser, and we see Ki Adamundi, Shakti, I'm not sure how to pronounce this, but it's Kukruk. It's a weapon Jedi. And we see Aayla Secura, who we know, Tar Seer, who is another Syrian, like Ki Adamundi, and Sha Gi. So our Scooby-Doo reference. And he
so
looks just
out
like
of
Shaggy.
Place. I know. And it's like, where in the heck did this even come from? Honestly.
It's a
but
nice
I mean
homage.
It was yeah definitely but I love the art on these Jedi and the way that they're so stylized for this particular type of animation. And Aayla is beautiful, Shakti is beautiful, Ki Adamundi is very buff.
Yeah,
but yeah, the whole aesthetic of this is a lot of fun.
Yeah. And Kukruk, if that's how you pronounce his name.
Kukruk. Yeah.
The Whippet Jedi is very bulky looking. He looks like he got a lot of power built into him there. And Tar Seer looks like a good legacy to Ki Adamundi, but he's got his cone part of his head kind of wrapped up there. So it was a nice take on him. It was nice to see another Syrian in this series here.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
So we get this variety of Jedi. And, you know, Ki Adamundi is noticing that they've been outmaneuvered, but, you know, advises the other Jedi, "Do not despair, you know, focus, we are Jedi." Then Grievous calls out to them, and this is a far different voice than what Matthew Wood came up for Revenge of the Sith. And so clearly this was something that was developed before they knew what the voice that they were going to settle on for Grievous in Revenge of the Sith and before there ever was the Clone Wars. What did you think of it?
Well, you know, of course, now that we have Matthew Wood, it seems out of place. It really does. But at the time, I mean, that was all that we had. And, you know, of course, just going back and forth, you just appreciate it for what it is in this particular art form, I guess, is the way that I look at it. But how about you?
it was fine. We didn't know any better, and quite frankly, by the time we, with the gap between these episodes and when we actually saw Revenge of the Sith in theaters, I kind of forgot about the difference in the voices.
That's a good point, too.
There's other things about Grievous that were far more noticeable, and we'll get to those in just a second. But he does call out to the Jedi and says, "You are surrounded." He's not going to give them mercy, but he will grant them a warrior's death. And then we start to see, we hear a noise, and it's the steps of Grievous approaching. But then all of a sudden they stop, and we get shots of the sweat beating up on Ki-Adi Mundi's head, and we start to see Shaggy panicking. And finally, he can't take it anymore, so Shaggy runs out into the clearing, only to have Grievous just fly from out of nowhere and crush him into a little puddle of goo there in the field. Poor Shaggy. If you read up on him in what's left of the Star Wars databank entry for him or on Wikipedia, you kind of learned that he was meant to be an assistant librarian at the Jedi Temple.
And here you
find him. He finds himself on Hypori in the middle of this battle that he really wanted nothing to do with. So
that is a fun little backstory. I did not know that. How cool.
Yeah. But poor then, guy. So this is our big reveal of what Grievous looks like. We got that shot of his foot. We got the shot of him from behind. But now we see him, and he's kind of got an appearance that is similar to what we see in Revenge of the Sith and then the Clone Wars, but not quite identical. What did you make of his look here?
Well, he's definitely a lot more robotic because his whole rib cage kind of opens up at that one point. And we know in Revenge of the Sith that he wanted to protect that area because that was the only part of him left that was actually human or alive. And so, it's definitely a lot more cyborg, a lot more just mechanical. But how about you?
Yeah, it adds another dimension to him. It gives him more moving parts that I suspect is probably more harder articulated. To animate. Yeah, for CGI for a movie than it is for 2D animation. But he's certainly menacing looking here, no doubt about it. But the Jedi, or the remaining Jedi at this point, retreat back into the cruiser. They're all back to back. And as they're backing up, kind of keeping an eye on everything around them, they don't notice that General Grievous is actually hanging from the ceiling above them. Until he lets go from his last talon on his foot and drops right into the middle of them, draws two lightsabers, and he begins spinning around at the waist and keeps all of them at bay at the same time. This Grievous in this fight is far more menacing than anything we saw in Revenge of the Sith or any of the episodes of the Clone Wars that I can remember.
Yes. And I think that that's by design too, because I feel that in Revenge of the Sith, he had to be portrayed as having some vulnerability, because otherwise you're not going to buy into the fact that Obi-Wan could take him out. You know what I mean? But he still had the spinning lightsabers in Revenge of the Sith, as we know, but they weren't quite like this. So, you know, I feel that in this series, he was meant to be this force that had to be reckoned with, but yet there was almost like no hope of being able to defeat him.
Sure. I just kind of feel like they backed off from this. I think this seems like what the original tent was for Grievous, because he was billed as this Jedi killer. He collects the lightsabers of the Jedi he slaughtered. But then when we get to Revenge of the Sith, which is the first time we've seen him, and that's not to say he was completely ineffective, but Anakin and Obi-Wan didn't have too much trouble with him and his Magna Guards when they first run into him in the movie and they chase him off. And then when Obi-Wan finds him on Utapau, he was a match for Grievous. I don't feel like Obi-Wan really had to overcome Grievous. He was not necessarily fighting against the odds. I kind of liked him better here.
That's a good point. Yeah.
He is so much more menacing here and capable. He's over the course of the battle here, because once he starts spinning at the waist and then he starts passing his sabers from hand to hand to foot as he's doing kind of handstands, as he's fighting them and adjusting in battle. At one point, he recovers Ki-Adi Mundi's lightsaber and is wielding three lightsabers at a time, one in each hand and one in a foot. There, he never actually splits his arms in half the way he does in Revenge of the Sith or any times in the Clone Wars. True. He doesn't resort to that tactic. He uses each one of his arms. So it's, again, it's another discrepancy between his design in Clone Wars and what follows from there. But he systematically wipes out these Jedi. You know, he leaps on a wall to get away from the Jedi. And then when he flips back into battle, he takes out Crook with a couple of saber swipes. He follows that up by grabbing Tarsier by the face with one of his feet, yeah, and then crushing him into the ground. He throws Aayla Secura into a wall, and then he begins fighting Ki-Adi-Mundi and Shaak-Ti again. He's got his blade spinning in his hands, which we have seen before, and he's holding them off. He kicks Ki-Adi-Mundi into a conduit, and then Shaak-Ti gets overwhelmed and thrown into another wall. And then when Ki-Adi-Mundi tries to summon his saber back to him, that's when Grievous grabs it with his foot. He now has three sit blades. Ki-Adi-Mundi is then forced to grab one of Grievous's lightsabers off his belt, Shades of Anakin, and from Revenge of the Sith. And this battle ends with Grievous making a leap at Ki-Adi-Mundi. And then we flash to Yoda, who has apparently sensed all this happening through the Force. Mm-hmm. And he ends the chapter by saying, "Darker the coming storm grows. I fear the dark cloud of the Sith shrouds us all." And then we get our credits.
Yep. Da, da, da.
What a conclusion.
definitely. And I love Grievous's, I call it his Daniel-san moment, when he has the three lightsabers and he's balancing.
Yeah. Crane technique.
Yes, exactly.
It's incredible. And I don't want to overstate it by saying the way he appeared in what follows is a disappointment. But like I said, this Grievous was threatening. This Grievous was menacing. Oftentimes in the course of the Clone Wars, Grievous came off almost more comedic than he did as a threat.
Mm-hmm. I can see that.
Because he constantly retreats from the Jedi. And Mace Windu will say things like, you know, Grievous is a coward. He'll run and hide like he always does. And yeah, what do we have that hold up? You know, this is the only other thing that we have that contradicts that. Mm-hmm. And they kind of did away with that. So I don't know. I kind of wish they had demonstrated this much level of threat and made him that much more menacing throughout the canon.
That's a good point, because his backstory is one that is just seething with revenge.
Mm-hmm.
And so, yeah, I can see where you're coming from with that. I guess I just kind of separate the two of them almost as not really different stories necessarily, but, you know, almost the same as you might separate a manga adaptation from an actual novel. You know, it's just sort of a different way to tell the story.
Yeah. I just remember before Revenge of the Sith came out that Grievous was built up to be this Jedi killer, and we never saw him kill a single Jedi in the movie. Yeah. And it was in Clone Wars, which ultimately got wiped out by the current canon. And this is what we had prior to that, that built up that reputation. Mm-hmm. And there is the deleted scenes of the various ways that Grievous kills Shaak-Ti. And, you know, we never got to actually see those in any official part of the canon. So we didn't get to understand how menacing and how threatening he could be. And what do we see of him in Revenge of the Sith? Well, he's on board of a Star Cruiser that's holding Chancellor Palpatine. Anakin and Obi-Wan board it. They defeat Count Dooku. Then they take him out. Or not take him out. They force him to retreat. And then Obi-Wan single-handedly defeats him on Utapau. I would like to have had other sources of this menace here that survived. But that's what I'm saying. That's my argument. And I still like Grievous. Don't get me wrong. I thought Matthew Wood did an excellent job giving him character and voice in what we regard as canon nowadays. But they could have done just a little bit more. There was other Jedi he has slain through time. But he never appeared more powerful and more threatening as he did here. And I'm going to get off, you know, the broken record and get past the scratch here.
No, you're fine. But I can tell you that Grievous was definitely the stuff of nightmares for my boys when they were little. Mm-hmm. Because I don't know if you remember, there was this plug-and-play training droid that came with its own lightsaber. And you had to work your way up through the ranks. And one of the things that you had to battle was Grievous. And I can remember my now almost 21-year-old just shaking in his boots getting to that level. And, you know, and this was just an animated type game. I still have that thing somewhere. I wonder if it works. I need to try it out. I'll report back.
Yeah. Well, here's the thing. Here's the other thing. If you looked at the Clone Wars, and you're asked to say, who would you rather face, Grievous or Asajj Ventress? Asajj Ventress, to me, seems less threatening. But then when you look at the Clone Wars, and you had to pick a combatant, who would you rather face, Asajj Ventress or General Grievous? I would much rather face Grievous. Asajj Ventress seems much more threatening there.
Right. True. Good point.
All right. Well, that brings us then to the end of Volume 1 of Clone Wars. Next week, we will pick up with Volume 2. And I'm not certain yet if we're going to get through all the chapters in one fell swoop or if we're going to take those on one at a time. We'll see. I'll let you know. But thank you all for listening to Episode 164 of Podcast Stardust and our discussion of Genndy Tartakovsky's Clone Wars. We'd like to remind you that you can find all episodes of Podcast Stardust over on the Riches at Podcast Network. And you can subscribe to Podcast Stardust on Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Spotify, Overcast, Amazon Music, or wherever it is that you listen to your podcast, including the RetroZap podcast feed. Just a couple more things before you go. If you don't mind, we'd love it if you could head over to Apple Podcasts or your podcatcher of choice and leave us a 5-star rating and review. Also, make sure to tell all your friends about the show, whether that's in person or on social media. And we'd love it if you'd hit us up on social media and let us know that you're listening, or just tweet out a show or share a show on Facebook that you've particularly enjoyed. That really does help us out. With all those things in mind, Jay, could you remind everyone where they might find us on the internet and around social media?
Sure. And ironically, the three main social media platforms are Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. So you could have a device in each hand and in your foot, and you could be following us on all three at the same time, just like Grievous. And if you want to reach out to Dennis on Twitter, he is at DJKVER2, and I am at Joyce Krebs. You can always check out our Pinterest page and our YouTube channel, and you can email us your thoughts at podcaststardust@retrozap.com. And if email is not your thing, you can always join us on our Discord room on the RetroZap Discord server. We are one of many, many shows over there. All the RetroZap shows are there, as well as some other fun dedicated rooms to some other interests as well. So just go to our show page, click on the community tab, and it'll take you right to where you need to go. And if you'd like to sport some Podcast Stardust love, you can go on over to TeePublic, where we are teepublic.com/user/podcaststardust. And there's lots of great show logo designs over there by Core Club from Coffee with Kenobi. And you can get everything from mugs to masks and sweatshirts and everything in between.
All right, then. That'll do it for episode 164 of Podcast Stardust. Thanks for listening, everyone. And until next time, may the Force be with you.